gonna innovate what I'm gonna. You can hate all you wanna, but you're still in your pajama. Now I ain't a prima donna, but I built what I wanna. Wanna. You can say my vision's wrong. The tune of my song broke my thumb.
Banging to my own drum.
Broke my thumb.
Banging to my own drum. Broke my thumb. Banging to my own drum.
Who in a clapping? Boots I am a strapping. A click click clacking.
Hurrah! Bootstrapping in America. Yeah, bootstrapping in America.
Think Circa is an online reading and writing platform where you will learn how to construct arguments about anything. What is an argument? Anytime we express an idea or opinion, we make claims that we want others to accept. We use evidence and reasoning to support those claims. Arguments help convince others that a claim is valid. Learning how to make arguments is something you'd work on in every class. When you discuss or write about a book, when you do an experiment and write a lab report, or when your math teacher asks you to show how you arrived at an answer, you are constantly making arguments to show your thinking. Arguments aren't just the focus of schoolwork either. People everywhere are making arguments all the time. Like when a detective solves a case, when a doctor recommends the right treatment, when someone interviews for a job, or wants to use the car. A strong argument shows your audience that you have the skills to read closely, think critically, and weigh evidence to make good judgments. Think Circa offers engaging topics and lessons that help you develop these skills. And it uses a process to build a strong argument. Form a claim or point of view in response to a reading. Provide evidence to back up your claim. Use reasoning to organize your evidence and show how it connects back to and supports your claim. Show that you understand other points of view. And learn to deliver your message in the language that works best given the audience and the occasion.
Thomas, we're back, my friend. Bootstrapping in America.
Think Circa in the house. Eileen, how are you?
Good, how are you?
So, I'm...
You've come to the right place for an argument, okay? What side do you want to be on?
I've been arguing all morning, okay? But we argue mostly about crazy things like strategies and things like implied volatility and all the things that... different standard deviations of things, all the things that won't turn on a single kid. And So I guess we got a little bit of the elevator pitch, but much of what you're doing is creating software, creating technology to empower teachers to teach kids to be more analytical?
Yeah. We essentially have created a software that actually really helps schools help teachers be more effective in their teaching of what we think are kind of the core skills of 21st century career and college readiness. So, when you walk into work every day, what you do is you probably read things that are kind of hard to read. Sometimes you read things that you've really had no background or exposure to, but you kind of figure it out and you synthesize things and then you make your own ideas and then you essentially share them with other people. And that's how we, problem solve. It's how we collaborate. It's how we learn on the job. And those are skills that don't just come built in to students. They're skills that have to be taught. And so they're usually not something that like a reading teacher can teach in 45 minutes. It takes a whole school to do it.
Right.
So we're really helping schools reorganize around student growth by sharing a common language around argumentation, which is kind of the core practice of it's what Aristotle was teaching. It's what somebody will be teaching 3,000 years from now. But we've sort of like jumbled everything up with a lot of jargon and made things more complex than they really need to be. But it all boils down to CIRCA, which stands for your ability to make a claim, support it with evidence, explain your reasoning, address a counterargument, and use the language that's appropriate for your audience. So if you can do that, you can pretty much do anything. You can be an entrepreneur and you can succeed in college.
It sounds so basic.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and I understand that throughout the years, there have been some great professors and great teachers at every level that have been able to deliver that message. But so my first question is, we all agree that that part's broken,
yeah.
that learning the processes to argue effectively probably has long been broken. But
mm-hmm.
Do you think that is kind of at really one of the core deficiencies, or are you addressing this because this makes, you have to solve things one step at a time? Like, I think there's a lot of core deficiencies mm-hmm. in today's, both public and private school systems. Mm-hmm. And we don't evolve because
yeah.
it's so expensive to evolve.
Right. Well, I think one of the challenges in schools is, and maybe, you know, for this audience, it might be useful to use the analogy of Salesforce. So imagine if every salesperson in an organization just got to pick their own customer relation management system, their own, you know, I'm going to do Salesforce, I'm going to do this or that. Yeah. Well, in schools, because we teach subjects, you know, I'm a math teacher, I'm a science teacher, an English teacher, we all kind of have our own thing that we have to do. The only thing that sort of is common across all grade levels and all subject areas is this core practice and this core goal. And so, as one of our advisory board members would say, if you can't explain it to your mother, then you don't understand it well enough yourself. So if we can teach kids to explain what they're learning in all subjects and measure them by the same yardstick and call things by the same name.
Yeah.
First of all, it allows a principal to lead a whole team with coherent data. It also allows students to understand that there is like commonality across this school day and that my problems are something I can identify and I can own and I can change, as opposed to like, I have no idea what you're talking about, because when you think about it, writing is really just so hard to teach somebody, because it's really somebody's critical thinking on paper. You can't tell someone how to do it. So calling things by the same name in itself will help schools be more coherent. And creating more effective organizations is what our software ultimately does. It just so happens that we're focused on instruction as opposed to, you know, managing the budget better. We're focused on managing instruction better.
It's a great point. I'm going to give you an analogy to what we do here. Tony and I talk to a lot of people every single day. And one of our goals is to allow the consumer, the self-direct investor, the consumer, whoever our audience is, our main goal is to be able to create enough information, interest, and engagement so that the average person can articulate finance at a completely different level. Mm-hmm. Because it's not about how much money you make. It's not about, you know, being smarter than the next person, being able to guess which way something's going to go. Mm-hmm. It's in our world, success is measured by your ability to articulate your subject. Mm-hmm. And the same thing, if you can explain finance in a logical, progressive manner to somebody that it's never been able to, it's never been done before on a consumer level, then we've accomplished something that's special.
Yeah.
Yours is very
same
similar.
Thing, research-based also.
Yeah. We built the technology to support the content, and what you're doing is virtually the same thing, except you're building the technology and the content simultaneously to support the same mission, which is, you said it very nicely, I would just say that kids can go home and they can completely articulate everything that they learned in school.
Well, one of the other challenges in schools, in addition to just being somewhat siloed, a little bit chaotic, not a whole lot of data captured on things that are really understandable to everyone. The other thing we do is provide 10 levels of differentiation, because if you go into and I used to think it was just a Chicago problem. Now that I've traveled the country for the past 2 years and seen highly resourced suburban schools with the same problem, the level of readiness of the average classroom could be anywhere from, you know, 2 to 3 grade levels all the way up to 10. And so a teacher can't possibly create high quality standards aligned content to deliver to all those students every day. And so what we were asking teachers to do was completely impractical. And
because it's not an elective. Like, it's a requirement.
Yeah. It's a requirement.
Right. This is an elective, so people that are here can choose to turn it off if they don't want
to. Yeah, yeah. But essentially, we were asking teachers to do something that was impractical, and by not delivering it through technology, we were asking teachers to spend the entire time they were with students doing live presentations instead of doing the one-on-one and small group things that actually helps you be a better writer. If you think about anybody or any step or help along the way you've had with learning how to write, it was one person saying, well, do you see how that sentence makes no sense there? Or when you did a pitch deck, they'll say, you know, do you see why this slide is unclear? That's what it takes to teach someone how to communicate this way. And it's an iterative process that's super time intensive. And if we have teachers standing in front of the class all day talking, they don't get that time with kids. So delivering the instruction to free the teacher from live presentation, giving them the resources to meet every student where they're at, and then allowing the whole team to be able to talk about a kid from the point of view of, can they explain math? Can they explain science? Can they explain English? then a principal actually has a really clear picture of, you know.
Okay, so I get the whole thing. It's cool as hell. It's perfect. You're going to save the world. I got it. I mean, it's I feel like it's the same kind of thing we're doing.
Yeah.
You know, different level, different topic, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But how do you build a business around this? Like this seems to me, you know, first of all, you're dealing with schools that already are pinched. They have, nobody has any money, and they have to make a decision on how to spend, you know, every penny.
Right.
So how do you deal with it? I mean, how do you grow? You're a for-profit organization, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So how do you build a business when your customers have no money?
Well, actually, our customers do have money. And
they do,
and
okay.
My background was I was in Chicago Public Schools, and I was both a teacher and an administrator.
So you know where they buried the money?
Well, here's the thing. I saw a lot of money being wasted because people were buying things that weren't going to work. And it was because there was essentially sort of a monopoly in the product marketplace. And so we had sort of like this Soviet, like one loaf of bread to choose from kind of system. And, you know, as I had been, you know, I started Peyton, which is the number one school in Illinois. It's an excellent college prep. When I tried to scale some of those practices by hand, you know, in live presentations, workshops, it wasn't going to work. So then I was like, well, we need technology. But when I looked at the technology product marketplace, it was read the passage and answer a multiple choice question in a cubicle. Kids were totally disengaged.
There's got to be a better way.
Yeah, we have iPads now. There's just so many better things we could do. And kids don't want to come to school all day and look at a screen and click on questions. They actually want to talk to their peers and they want to talk to a teacher. So I knew we could do better, and I knew we could do it cheaper, and I knew that the quality could be improved, because if you make the price point accessible, which a lot of education technology had not been, because again, there was no competition, that if we made the price point accessible for all schools, not just for the best schools or the schools with the most money for addressing students with extra needs or whatever, but for all schools, that for a much lower price, we could deliver a much higher quality. And it had to be a for-profit organization simply because if we could make up the Great Gatsby, like Sal Khan makes up his math lessons, we would. But we know that schools were spending money on buying products that weren't the Great Gatsby. They were buying passages written by somebody just to have a multiple choice practice kind of thing. So we basically, you know, took the leap and found that schools were really excited about partnering with us in the design. And that they recognized the savings, the cost savings, just in terms of time, in terms of the actual resources. I mean, things like buying, you can't buy 10 levels of text for every teacher, but you can deliver that for the same price.
So how many schools are using ThinkCirca?
So today we have 149 schools that are subscribing, so almost 30,000 students. And then we also have a free element that we engage new users with. And we have users in all 50 states and 30 countries. And in our subscribing schools, we have schools in 13 different states. So schools have the money and are spending it more wisely. And in that sense, because what we're offering is high value at a lower cost, we're actually, I think, fitting into a lot of budgets where they're able to actually save a lot of money.
Eileen, it's a great story. She's Eileen Murphy. She's the CEO and founder. Right? You're the CEO and founder? Perfect.
Yep.
Of ThinkCirca. And it's a name you're going to hear, Bet, down the road, because not only do you have a who's who list of investors, but you also have an amazing idea, which I want to say is very complimentary to the Tasty Trade world or the way that we're thinking. So I wish this was around when I would have a much better show here every single day if Tony had had this software so he could be intelligently argumentative with me.
Well, there you go. It's all about disciplined reasoning.
Instead of just sitting here like a spineless fish.
Yeah.
That's right. Disciplined reasoning. I like that.
Yeah. And the other important thing I just want to mention is that the other piece that makes a business and education technology work is student outcomes. And so after a year of implementation, we have awesome student outcomes, and we've caused students enormous amount of growth. And so that's – we've helped teachers and schools accomplish that. And, you know, eventually maybe we'll be helping colleges and we'll be helping the professional world in doing it.
It's a great story. It really is. Thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Take care.
We're going to be back in about 3 minutes. We got good trade, bad trade next.
Yeah.
Thank you. It's okay.